everyone. I know it's post-lunch, but we're going to have a very interesting conversation today. If you could just make your way in, sit down, don't get too comfortable. Ask me some thought-provoking questions. Maybe we close the door? So we are in the coolest panel today, the education panel. This is, in my opinion, the most entertaining slash engaging slash we will learn so much today, and hopefully we'll come together for some create some very good solutions. Yes, I see the energy in the background. Thank you. Good. Are you starting off on good energy? So we have a fantastic panel here today. We reshuffled it. You can't see the projection, so I'm just going to walk through who we have today in the room. I think you all know me already from this morning. My name is Carine. I am now the moderator of this panel. I have a long-ish background in education. I've been working on education ever since my career started. I have worked on non-formal education in refugee settings. I've done transformational education programs with governments in the Middle East. And I recently was the co-founder, the co-founder of Idrak, the online MOOC platform in Jordan. Today we have with us Maysa Jalbout, the CEO of the Ghurair Foundation, Abdullah Hafiz, the founder of Al-Madina Academy, and Hassan Al-Damluji, who was previously the moderator of this panel. And who runs the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation as the Middle East rep. And we're gonna get started. So currently we are in a bit of an education crisis in the region. We all know what is going on in terms of low student outcomes, high costs for students that are currently being spent. A lot of different strategies are in place. We also have the refugee situation, disadvantaged students. There are a lot of problems, bad teachers, non-qualified teachers, and things that aren't being licensed, and a lot of different approaches that are currently utilized. I think that's all clear. I think we all have a good understanding that education is an issue that needs to be solved in the region. So we really want to focus on in this conversation, what are the tactical solutions? So let's not just focus on let's understanding the problems deeper and deeper, but really look at how do we exit this room knowing what are the three things that need to happen to make education better. And I'd really love if you can also leave knowing what you can specifically do to make education better in your own communities and take leading roles and to be a part of that transformational change. Just diving a little deeper on who we have with us today. So I would like to start our conversation off with Maysa Jalbout, who is currently the CEO of the Ghurair Foundation, a massive new education foundation based out of Dubai. She's also a Brookings Fellow, has worked throughout her career in education in Canada, developing countries in the Middle East, and has a strong focus on underserved youth. She has recently wrote the education strategy for Syrian refugees that was recently endorsed by Gordon Brown. Her special topics are technology and conflict, and we're going to start our conversation off with a question to you, Maysa, if I may. I'll hand you over the mic. Is being very solution-oriented, is technology really the silver bullet people think it is to transform education in the Arab world? We see a lot of technology initiatives, approaches, but are they working? And should we continue to utilize technology when thinking of reshaping education?
Thank you very much, and thank you everyone for joining us. I know you have lots of options this afternoon, so we appreciate you thinking that education is a priority. And to the question, technology is not a silver bullet. What we need to do in this region is fix the education system, but we have a massive opportunity to use technology to leapfrog forward, to address some of the critical challenges that we're facing. One of the greatest challenges is access. With something like 8.5 million children and youth having never been in school across the region, and that number rising significantly every day, with now millions of Syrian refugees out of school, Iraqis, and other parts of the region that are suffering from conflict, we have to address the issue of access. Of course, conflict is not the only reason that children are out of school. Poverty is one of them. Gender barriers is another. And also access to rural areas. So technology provides us with an opportunity to increase access to those children specifically. Unfortunately, up until now, we have underutilized technology. We are seeing lots of new initiatives pop up that are very, very promising, that are working at a very respectable scale now, where they could benefit from investment and scaling up, and also a deep dive into evaluating their impact. A recent paper that the Brookings Institution just released that I wrote, it focuses on the technology disruption and whether or not it will close the skills gap in the region. If you're interested in those topics, I really recommend you take a look at it, because we highlight some of those interesting initiatives that are taking place in the region. As an example, Nefham is an online portal out of Egypt that has put the Egyptian as well as Syrian curriculum online. If you take a look at what they're doing, you'll see that for every component that they put up, hundreds of thousands of people are accessing that information. What's really interesting is not just that people are clicking through to that content, but they're actually contributing to it. They're creating their own modules and putting them up, and those are being shared. Originally, when that model was created, the idea was to try to increase access for those young people in Egypt that are not accessing the education system. But what they found was women across the region, in Saudi Arabia, in other places, are actually accessing the portal. So something like that is very much worth looking at. Idraq, which Carine has worked on, is producing content that's not necessarily accredited content, but very interesting on topics that are of great interest to youth around the region. Other initiatives as well that are working with things like coding, which is a skill that young Arabs, we're behind in so many ways on that skill. We're starting to see initiatives come about that are training. So lots and lots of examples. So it's not a silver bullet, but it is a huge opportunity to leapfrog forward. And I would also like to say that we pay a lot of attention to access in general around the world, not just in the region. But our biggest challenge in the Arab world is quality. And the thing about education in technology is that it is an opportunity for us to access education wherever it may be, and very high content, very good content from around the world. Unfortunately, in our region, we are still looking at education technology and online learning in a very, very traditional way. Not a single Arab country actually allows or endorses or accredits online education, which is a huge challenge for youth in the region, who want to be able to access content from top universities in the world, but are worried that their governments will not recognize their degrees. We need to change that. We need to allow our young people to access education from wherever it may be. And if we don't pay attention to that, the train is gonna pass while we're still, thinking about those very basic issues. I could go on and on, but I should probably let other panelists.
Thank you, Maysa. I think I hear a lot of what you're saying, and I see it resonating a lot in the field. Quality is a major issue. Content as well, the quality of the content that's being put up online. And finally, the accreditation point you made, I think, is a major challenge. And actually one that can be, if we have school leaders, system leaders in the room, one that can be put on top of the portfolio and actually worked on immediately. There are a lot of interesting options, interesting models that are going on around the world. I think it's a great one to start tackling immediately. Still on the quality front, I'd like to move on to you, Hassan. Hassan, if you all know, is with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. which is the world's largest philanthropic education funder, has worked previously with McKinsey for 5 years with different education systems all over the world, and has established two nonprofit organizations himself in the UK. Hassan, my question to you on the quality question. What about our teachers? So our teachers that are entering the room, our students are going to be limited to what our teachers know, right? So your students, in very rare situations, is this not the case, but the students are going to be limited to what the teachers know and to the quality of their teachers. How can we just depend on these one-off great success stories of teachers? How do we bring this quality issue up and create it to be a more consistent standard? What do we do with our teachers, which are usually the people who are the lowest scoring graduates out of their universities who move on to this profession? What do we do, and how do we solve this issue?
Great, thanks, Carine. And thanks to Maysa for making some really important points, and thank you for asking me to talk about a very different issue, which is also crucially important. And not to, you know, plug this issue over others, but I you know, we were just talking outside during lunch, and I said, and I feel like we were all agreeing that if you give me a good teacher and you put them under a palm tree and you don't even give them a book and they have a student, I'd rather my kid went to there as a school than the best technology enabled with a basketball court and a theater, but the teacher sucks. The teacher's no good. So good teachers are the only absolutely critical enabler to good education. And then everything else is a nice to have, or can enable the teacher to do their work better, or can improve things. But a good teacher is the only absolutely critical enabler. And if you don't have a good teacher, you can forget the whole thing. That's what I would say. And another thing that I want to say early on, in terms of kind of establishing this debate, and draw it back to some of the issues that were being mentioned in the earlier panels. Because earlier on today, we heard a lot about the problems in the Arab world. And we also heard the head of the Omani Airports Authority, who said that, you know, education is the key. And I was thinking, that's a great plug for our panel. But so to try and tie this back a little bit, we don't need any more islands of excellence. We have islands of excellence. The problem with the Arab world is that, and you know, and everyone in this audience is an example of the product of the islands of excellence that exist. You know, I'm from Iraq originally, and you know, because I'm fortunate, I have a British passport, I can travel, I have a good education, I can get a job. So this exists. The problem is scale. The problem is the 80% of people or 90% of people who don't have access to that. And what's on the line here is not just jobs, although jobs are important. It's the disconnect that Arab people feel with their elites. And if you're disconnected from your elite because they have opportunities and you don't, because they speak English but you only speak Arabic, because they have a passport and can travel to Britain but you're stuck in your country, for all of these reasons, if you're not connected to your elites, you start having a lot of political problems. Because you have two options. I'll use the Iraqi example. You either have Muqtada Sadr, who speaks to the people but is himself uneducated, or you have the people who spent 30 years living in Iran or America and did get an education but have no connection to their country. Now, Iraq is an extreme example, but you can see across the Arab world this problem that the people don't feel represented. And one of the key solutions to that is to raise the level of education and therefore opportunity of the masses, so that they can participate in the economy, which is exciting for all of us in the room, and the opportunities that are exciting and available for all of us in this room. So if that's the issue, then how do we do that? So it's got to be fixing the system, and it's got to be getting hundreds of thousands of high-quality teachers in front of students. Unless we're talking about a small country like Qatar or Bahrain, if we're talking about a country like Saudi or Iraq or Syria or Yemen, or rich or poor, a large, we're talking about hundreds of thousands of teachers at high quality every day turning up to school and teaching kids. So that's the problem we need to fix. And then we need to keep them in the classroom, because the best people getting promoted straight away into management roles, you know, nice as it is for them because they don't have to worry about kids causing problems, is not gonna be what keeps children educated at scale. So the problem we have is that, as Carine mentioned, the worst graduates become teachers. And that's for two reasons. One is because we haven't excited people that teaching is a dynamic profession which we respect. And the second reason is that governments have used the hundreds of thousands of job openings that there are in the teaching profession as a way of hiring people to the government to keep them off the streets. So both there aren't enough good people wanting to be teachers, and it's a great way of hiring just anybody, with the result, of course, that the most important role in the country is given to just anybody. There are always examples of great teachers, even in the public system. But again, whether it's public or private, we don't need islands of success, islands of excellence. We need systematic change. So how do you do it? We have to be very brave. Carine said it absolutely right. This is an emergency. The fact that it's going on for a long time, that the train is slowly hitting the wall, doesn't make the casualties any fewer, and it doesn't make it any less of an emergency. We need to be very, very brave. That means, for example, we need to reduce the number of teachers we have in countries where we've hired too many people. We need to fire teachers. I'm sorry to say it, but we need to fire, even if they're nationals of a country, we need to be able to fire teachers. And we need to be able to say no. Governments have to say no to two key groups. Here's what I see going wrong as a result of governments not saying no. They don't say no to parents, and they don't say no to teachers. Parents and teachers are both citizens. The government wants to provide for their citizens, and that's a very noble thing. But sometimes providing means saying no. So what should we be saying no to parents? I've spent a lot of time in the Gulf education system, so I'll speak more about that. If the parents in a small village, they want their own school, a small rural community, they get their own school because they asked for it. No, we don't have the scale in your village. Sorry, your children have to go to the next door village because that's where the school is that we can have scale. So what happens? You have a subscale school that can't provide education because we didn't want to say no to the parents. Parents want their teachers to pass, so they get into a university and get a piece of paper. You have to be able to say no, because it's important that we keep the standards of that university high, and the piece of paper needs to mean something. So your kid did not reach that level. The answer is no. And then teachers not only want a job, but they also want to work nearby where they live. Even though, you know, sometimes the population of the school may be far away, and so you have schools which are unable to attract teachers. Even though the government could tell that it's a government school, you go over there and you teach over there. Well, it's a long car journey, and so we don't tell them no, and again, we have these. So I think the critical thing here is the bravery to say no to the people who we want to serve, but we're not serving well, by telling them that the short-term demands that they want should trump the long-term demands that we all have, which is that our education are well-educated. So what would that really look like? And I'll finish here, and then we can obviously carry on talking. I think the charter school model has been a very powerful one in the US, and it's been introduced now in the UK under a different name, academies, and in Sweden it's called free schools. But the point is to have government schools which are free for people to attend, which don't charge fees, which are for all citizens and at scale, but are run independently. And the meaning of run independently effectively means that the staff are not employees of the state, they're employees of the organization that's running the school. Now, in the UK, there has to be a charity, so there's no profit making out of it. And that's a decision you could make. If you feel that there's a charitable sector strong enough to provide that schooling, great. If you feel that actually you need to have a profit incentive, otherwise you won't get school providers coming in, maybe you go for the profit incentive. But the idea is suddenly, instead of saying, I am the employee of the government and I, you know, go home at 2 p.m. or whatever it is, it's these people have to respond to their customers. Because rather than citizens, or you know, beneficiaries or whatever, no, these are customers that you have to serve. And that change of mindset, I think, has been powerful in the countries where it's been implemented, but it will be even more powerful in this area because of the issues that I already stated. So we have to say no to the endless government jobs. We have to say no to the parents who want a piece of paper for their child and don't yet realize the importance of that piece of paper having value. And I think bringing in outside expertise, and it doesn't mean from other countries necessarily, but outside of the system, is a prerequisite to success. Thank you.
Thank you, Hassan. I think your first point on education truly underpinning everything? I think it's come up in every discussion that we've had so far. In the innovation economy one, of course, the root is education. In the politics one, the citizenship element is all done through your educational systems, both formal and informal. Then you mention the teacher restructuring and knowing what to say no and knowing what trade-off you're making when you're making your decisions, and how big of an impact that's making on the students at the end is also very important. I'm interested to hear about what our audience thinks about the charter school model and its use in the Middle East, and we'll leave that one open for the Q&A that we'll be doing shortly. So have some thoughts towards that, especially. I'd be very curious to hear. Our last but not least panelist, Abdullah Hafiz. So Abdullah is a bit of a different person with us today. Abdullah actually is a businessman and doesn't have the biggest education background, different from Hassan and from Maysa, but has seen an opportunity and has recognized the opportunity of education and its connection actually to the business world, and has founded Al-Madina Academy, which is a soon-to-be state-of-the-art school in Medina, and as a nonprofit funded by an endowment. So it's another one of his initiatives, including along with many other of the successful businesses he's been a part of. So Abdullah, what lured you into the education world? That's the first thing, from a business standpoint. So what was the business case for you for entering education? And then the second thing I'd also like to understand is, given that you are now involved in education, what are the different operating models that you think are good ones to adopt? So what do we think is the right way to move in terms of for-profit schools, things that are funded by non-profit systems, and the public education system as well?
Thanks a lot, everyone, for spending some time with us here. Thanks a lot for the panel here. I'll just try very quickly to give some background. Maybe it's like kind of a personal story, what actually drove me into education. And then I will try to answer the question as part of slightly general answer, I would say. But what started this whole thing with me was Harvard. I finished my high school, and as they say, على قدر أهل العزم تأتي العزائم. I aimed at actually attending either Harvard or MIT for some reason. I think Cambridge for some reason. And I applied at both, and I did not get accepted. And I tried, I think, for about 4 years applying, get rejected. And then after that, they said, please stop applying. You will not get accepted. So then I thought, what should I do if that is the answer? And they said, what the hell, let me start the Harvard of the East world, I would say. So from there, I had a very long educational, and I studied in like 5 different universities, trying to figure out what is the educational model that will feel encouraging, satisfying, and what I'm basically looking for. Then I dropped school before I graduate a year and went into business. Worked in business for about 15 years, started 6 or 7 different companies. 4 of them were in the IT. Then finally I got my BS in mathematics from Northeastern University, which is not that far from MIT and Harvard. And then I got my master's from Boston University in computer information systems. After working all of that time, I still had this dream of actually starting this university that will one day, I know it might not be in the coming 50 years, but one day, inshallah, maybe my grandson would be able to celebrate having the number one university in the world. So I realized that graduate education or university education is just the end of a very long path, which is basically starts when you are about, actually it starts when you're like 3 days old, but officially starts when you're about 3 or 4 years old. And this foundation is extremely, extremely important between 4 years old until you're 18 years old. And I thought that before I actually try to do something at the university level, we definitely need to look at K-12 education. I started I spent about 5 years searching different educational systems around the world. I visited about, I would say, the 50 best schools in the Western part of the world, between US, Canada, UK, Switzerland, Germany, Turkey. Basically, what are the best schools in a particular city, and I would go and just visit, trying to figure out what makes good schools and what do we need to create. After that, I had a clear vision, what do we want to do? And then we started this foundation, which is Al-Madina Al-Munawwara Educational Academy. And that was basically the start of maybe moving into transforming this dream into an actual reality, inshallah. So what have I learned from this, I would say, 5 years and visiting different schools? And there are 6 challenges that I think we have in our world that we need to find solutions. And hopefully if we do that, we would be able to really create an outstanding educational system. And let me start maybe by answering your question, because it talks about the organizational structure. That's my personal observation. I might be wrong, but about 95% of the exceptional schools I visited around the world were all non-profit schools. That does not mean that they don't charge extremely high fees, like in the range of $40,000 to $50,000 per kid. But they are non-profit. I don't know if some of the schools, their endowments are over $1 billion. I visited a school that has 300 kids, a high school, and their endowment is about $100 million. So this just to give a very quick background of maybe my personal understanding of how good education should work. It needs to be non-profit. That does not mean, I mean, saying non-profit, that it does not mean that, I mean, definitely you need to charge tuition for continuity. Definitely you need to pay extremely high salaries to be able to attract the good teachers. And definitely you need to maintain extremely high quality, which will eventually cost a lot of money. So we're not talking about non-profit means low quality, which is something very popular, at least in our side of the world. So I think that's the first lesson I learned. The other thing I wanted to talk about, and if you allow me, I would like to stand. I don't like to sit a lot, so I will try to stand, which is, I think, is extremely important. And it might be a little bit, when I started this, I had a lot of I would say, people didn't like what I'm saying that much. But I think the Arabic language is one of the biggest problems that we have in our educational system today. All the exceptional good schools in our countries, in the Arab worlds, are in English. And please, don't take my word. Go do your research, read history, and check any civilization that has built itself. They use their own, their mother tongue language, which is extremely important. I'll give very, very quick examples. Germany, Japan, Turkey, all of those people who were able to actually do innovation, solve their economical problems. So Arabic is an extremely important thing, and this is what we're trying to do in Al Madina Academy. Arabic needs to be the first language, the mother tongue, especially in the elementary school. Definitely, you need to be exceptional in English, especially if I want to send my kids to MIT and Harvard and Yale and Stanford and all of these exceptional, so they need to get really, really high scores in all these standards exams. But it's very important that they have an extremely strong Arabic foundation and Arabic language. So that's the second thing. The third thing that is extremely important, and I see very clearly missing, at least in Saudi Arabia, but I'm sure all the other Gulf countries and Arab countries are very similar to that, is the community involvement in the educational, in the educational life of their kids. That's very important. We tend to, especially maybe in Saudi Arabia, because unfortunately until now women don't drive, but so basically they send the kids with the drivers and they throw them in the school and they pick them up at 3 or 4, which is a disaster. So there is a huge disengagement between the parents and the kids. You would never be able to raise a healthy human being if they are detached from their family, their parents. So, and again, this is what we try to do. So our project, for example, just as an example, is not a school. It's like an educational campus where we have about 40% of our campus is open to the community, which is a very, very important and critical issue. So for example, just a very quick thing. Our KG or kindergarten school, we don't call it Rawda or something. We call it Mother Center. We call it Mother Center because we want to emphasize on that mothers need to be part of this. Kids between like 3 years old and 6 years old, they need their mothers to be with them. So it's very important. We understand that there are a lot of working mothers and stuff like that, but they need to dedicate at least a day a month or something to spend in the school with their kids. So that's the third thing. The fourth thing, I'm sorry, my memory is not very good, but I'm trying to, yeah. The fourth thing that is also, which is fundamental here, is the teacher's problem. So part of our project, for example, is a teacher's academy. Because we understand that we cannot keep depending on expats or people coming from outside, and so we need to start creating our own teachers who would be able to actually carry on the message. And so this sustainability model is extremely important. We're not building something for 5 or 10 or 15 years. Again, I visit schools that are 250 years old. We don't even have a single company in the whole Arab world that is maybe older than 100 years old or something. As soon as the father dies, then the kids start fighting and they basically the whole thing goes off. So I think it's very important, this continuity. How do we think about teachers? How we can make sure that teachers will deliver the quality that we want? Because at the end of the day, teachers are the real main players. The whole school, basically, teachers. You have nothing else. So teachers, let me try to remember the remaining stuff. The last thing that I'm gonna talk about. The other thing that I noticed that is very, very crucial and important, which is innovation and thinking skills. I don't think we need to teach our kids anymore what is the capital of France or how is the weather and whatever, these things. Everything is available here, and soon, maybe in 5 years, they don't even need a device. They would be able to recall the information without even needing a device. So what's really important is that we set our kids with the right thinking tools that they need to succeed in whatever. They want to be football players, they would be successful. They want to be entrepreneurs, they want to be teachers, they want to be doctors, lawyers, whatever. They will be successful because they have the right, skills that will help them succeed in their life. Thanks a lot, and I'm extremely sorry for taking maybe longer than the time.
Thank you very much, Abdullah. I think personally what resonated with me the most was the language element that you discussed. And I think we forget how important our own mother tongue is to us, the language that's spoken at home. Because language informs the constructs in your mind, and thus informs pedagogy. So the way you understand things is highly correlated to the way things are actually structured in your mind, the way your thought processes, your logic approaches. So we should think about that connection when choosing what kind of model to put our children in and what language should be the first choice. I want to open up the questions to the audience. And there are a lot that I also still want to ask. So I'm going to couple some of yours and perhaps group them in so that we can ask even more deep questions to our panelists, especially considering time. So do we have runners with mics? So the first three hands that I saw were yours, and then yours. Khalid, we'll get to you in the next round.
Hi there. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. This has been a wonderful conversation. This question, I'm interested to hear from you, Abdullah, but feel free to chime in, anyone else. In the ecosystem, you touched on this, that supports a child's learning, you have the teacher and the school, you have the parent, but you, I would also argue you have the community. And in the Arab world, I think the community often lends itself to the Islamic community, mosques, and hence religious education becomes intertwined with public education. So my question to you is, how do we continue to foster schools and learning environments that foster critical thinking and debate, but also without isolating the religious community, because we know that's so deeply rooted in our society here. And two, if we don't, is non-denominational education in terms of the public sector, is that what is necessary?
Thank you. Our next question. So it's to the lady in the back.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Noura Sindhi. I'm a consultant in government and education at PwC. My question is for Ustad Abdullah. First of all, thank you so much for bringing the point about the importance of Arabic language. I agree with you 1,000%. Now, the challenge is that, unfortunately, there's a huge disconnect between the public education system, the type of information that our children receive in schools, and the reality on the ground in terms of innovative learning and education technology. Now, in my view, this is in large part due to the dearth of Arabic content that is being generated both online and offline. I guess my question to you is, what are we doing, or what can we do in the GCC to address this gap, and what role, if any, can our governments play? Thank you.
Thank you. And then for the first round of questions, we just have this third person over here, and then we'll do another round. You. And please also tell us your name. We have two Nuras and?
Melda.
Melda, thank you.
So we mentioned Arabic, but I also wanted to talk about Arabic history or the history of the Arab world. I personally grew up in Lebanon, and Lebanese history was entirely omitted from our textbooks just because the government hasn't been able to agree on one common mm-hmm. history of the country. That's because we're a post-conflict society. Sadly, there are gonna be a lot more of those countries, Syria, Libya, on and so forth, coming up. So how can we use innovation to teach critical thinking, talking about kind of different sectarians? I mean, those are all critical issues that must be addressed on a student level in order to foster the new Arab world.
Thank you. Thank you, Melda. So three very different and very interesting questions. I want to kind of redistribute based on what we discussed. Abdullah, I'd like you to take the question on how to foster schools that promote critical thinking without the isolation of the religious education and the religious community. There was a question from Noura over here on language in Arabic, and I think that's a very interesting one in terms of content development online, Arabic content development, and what we can do about that, and some good solutions, Maysa, if you could do that. And then Hassan, I'm giving you the history one. If you could let us know about how can we intertwine history and learning from our past for progression in the future? So let's do make them maybe 2 minute answers.
Very quickly, I think we have a very interesting challenge here is that we need to understand what religion is, I guess, in our part of the world. My understanding of my own religion, the teachings of my religion that I believe in, is all around critical thinking and being able to, and freedom, and being able to choose whatever you want to do based on your, and because this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask us about, is what we choose to do, not what we've been enforced to do. So I think if we do some kind of mind shifting regarding the understanding of what religion is and what we should be teaching in schools, this will basically solve the roots of the problem rather than actually trying with the same set of minds that we have today. I think it would be extremely hard to teach kids the religion that they are trying to teach them and teach them free thinking and critical thinking and give them these kind of skills.
I want to address something that I think that is, and I see that it resonated with the audience, Abdullah's comment about studying in Arabic and how important it is to study in mother tongue, which I fully agree with and is proven scientifically. But I want to point out something that's extremely crucial. In looking at the skills that are needed for young people to enter the job market and to work in future jobs, they have to be able to be fluent in multiple languages. So learning in Arabic is not enough, and we have to be careful not to mix the fact that the youth in the Arab region still have the lowest English proficiency in the world. So when we talk about our kids studying in English, we're talking about privileged kids, my kids, Abdullah's kids, going to private international schools. That does not represent the vast majority of kids around the region. The vast majority of kids around the region do not know English. They, you know, all the Syrian refugee kids that are out of school now, that are being integrated into schools in Turkey, Lebanon, and Jordan, do not know another language other than Arabic. They're having huge problems integrating because of that. So let's just be very, very careful about that. The other thing is, it's not enough to just know Arabic and English. Digital literacy is becoming a critical literacy. If our kids are not literate in using computers, in coding, and all of those critical aspects of future jobs in STEM education, they won't find jobs. So when we think about the role of education, we have to think about what is it preparing them for? The kinds of jobs that are coming up, when we talk about recalling the kind of technology that's going to produce the information that's instantaneous, we have a choice to make. We can either be users of technology or we can be creators of technology. And when we're talking about technology, I'm not just talking about computers, I'm talking about health. You know, I'm talking about the way we're treated, the way that we learn in the future, the way that we, you know, impact our environment. Everything is going to be influenced with that. So I really just wanted to make sure that, you know, we came back to that critical issue. And also, when we talk about school models, we talk about the importance of what makes education critical. We often go back to the school model as we know it, the traditional school model. And it has been proven time and again in the last 15 years, during which the whole world was working towards the Millennium Development Goals, that the traditional school model is never going to get us there alone. I'm not saying that it's not good. I send my kids to school, a normal school. But what we're seeing is that the kind of learning that's taking place outside of the school system is just as critical, if not more critical, than what's happening inside the classroom, the traditional classroom. So let's also be cognizant of that. And the last point, as far as Arabic content is concerned, it's extremely important. It comes back to the point of, are we users or are we generators of content? Having Arabic content means that we're able to project our culture, our ideas, our history You know, there's so much that's going on in generating Arabic content, and I'm very sad to say that it's actually not within our region. The biggest Arabic translation and production content production is taking place in a consortium of Western universities. They've actually taken some of our most important books in time and are making them digitizing them and making them accessible to the world through Western libraries. So yes, it's extremely crucial, extremely important. And what I would also say just on that is that I don't see those things that I've just highlighted as only challenges. I see them as huge opportunities. I think young people in the region are very, very ready to tackle those challenges if only we provide them with the opportunity to do so. I haven't talked about the work that I'm doing through the foundation that I'm leading, but would love to talk to anyone who's interested afterwards. One of the key things that we're trying to do is to make sure that we reach those young people that have that kind of potential, but do not have the opportunity to do that. Part of what we're doing is going to be sending them to universities abroad, but also we need to bring and create quality education right here in our region. And that's what we plan to do. Thank you.
Great, thanks. And I'll try and be quick, mainly because I want to hear more questions, because those are incredibly good questions. And I just want to thank Carine for just making sure we opened it up to the floor, because then you realize, actually, you know, a lot of us might work in education, but we're by no means the only experts in the room. So thank you for those great questions. I want to start off by praising Abdullah so that I can be very mean about him next, because I think there's one thing I very much agreed with what you said, and there's something else I very much disagreed with what you said. And it is the Arabic, and I was one of the many people applauding when you said that. And you know, for me, it was just coming back to this idea of the, and Maysa really spoke to it, the gap between the elite and the people that I was talking about in my opening comments. Because actually, yes, most Arab kids don't speak English, but the ones who do speak English are the ones who should be our authors, but aren't writing in Arabic because they don't know Arabic well enough. And they should be our, even just the reading public, which in any country is a, you know, how many people read novels? And the ones who should be reading novels are reading English novels. And so that's a huge cultural disadvantage that we have. And I'm going to tie it to what you asked me to answer about, which was history. But I think they're intimately linked. Very quickly, an anecdote. You know, I was brought up in the UK, and my mother's not Arab. And so I didn't speak Arabic growing up. And for me, that was a source of great feeling of loss. And so when I came to university, I learned Arabic, and I learned about Arabic history, Arab history. And can you imagine my disappointment to find that so many of the people I then and still meet who, unlike me, have two Arab parents, and many of whom grew up in the Arab world, and my Arabic is better than theirs now? And my knowledge of Arab history is better than theirs, because I studied in Western universities, which, as Maysa said, they're the universities that are producing the content. So it was a source of great sadness to me to realize that I know more about Iraqi history than the people who went to school in Iraq, who are educated people, by the way. I'm not talking about the taxi driver. So coming back to the history question, now here's my dagger in Abdullah's back. So you said that we shouldn't, you'll appreciate a little bit of, we're not all agreeing here. It's absolutely important that they know what the capital of France is. To the point about history, it's even more important they know what the capital of Lebanon is, but also they should know the capital of France, because knowledge is not separable from the skills that you use that knowledge with. And there's a lot of great education research about this, and you know, you talked about being impact-driven. This isn't a policy solution, this is a reading recommendation for the audience, which is a book called Why Kids Hate School. It's a fantastic book. I don't know if you, but it's a fantastic book, and it goes through a lot of the research and proves that unless you, it's like saying you need a good architect for your house, we don't need bricks. And of course you need a good architect for the house, but you better have some bricks or concrete or steel. You need some building material, and knowledge is the building material through which we apply the skills, without which we don't, the skills don't have any base. So yes, we need to move beyond the knowledge curriculum, but not to throw it away. And yes, that knowledge curriculum should definitely include knowing about our own region. Thanks.
I just wanted to highlight a few things that our speakers mentioned, and to add some hard facts that I know about Arabic and the content and what's available online. Do you know that the country of Greece publishes more content, like books, publishes more books than the entire Arab region combined? Another thing is we have about 1%, I think, or maybe a little less than 1% of all websites currently online, the 10.1 million websites that are online are currently in Arabic. So we have a little bit of work to do in terms of creating content, both online and offline. And I think we're all here in the room, and that's something that we can all take a part in doing. I highly agree with this point that Maysa made, that ultimately we want kids to get jobs and have careers and develop themselves further and continue to learn throughout their lives. And that doesn't happen in just one language, but it happens in multiple. And I think the common concern, the common complaint that comes from employers is employees can't speak English. And we live in an ever-globalizing economy. And if my employees can't communicate with someone from another country, then they're not so good to me. They're not people that I want to hire anymore. Let's do another round, one final round. And I know Hassan will have to run to the airport. too many hands. So let's do you, and you.
You go over there, you teach over there. Well, it's a lot.
My name is Michael Katz, and I've been in the Gulf for a very long time. And actually, my question is related to when I started in 1975 in Saudi, fresh out of university. My employer said to me, what I want you to do, there's nothing that you don't know about engineering, but I want you to help me to teach my people how to work. And to me, he was my mentor, my second father, everything. He was one of the first in the Gulf to start Saudiization. He wanted his people to work in all different fields as well. My main question is, and one thing that I've watched over all these years, is that the curriculum, to me, is the center point of education. It hasn't changed fundamentally since I went to school. And the curriculum that I had the great benefit to have in Canada growing up included things like woodwork shop and metal shop and automotive. And these occupational parts of the curriculum were incredibly important, because actually they even had females. Girls took a job, they took other things, but it gave us a basis for other avenues in which to be employed. And we are facing in the Gulf, 65% of the population is under 30, and an immense, the big elephant in the room is that we have a huge unemployment situation. And I blame partly the education system that doesn't teach kids enough to be able to come into the workforce. We're all teaching them to go into university. This is not possible, and it's not practical. It doesn't create a culture in a society. And partly that there's a cultural aspect, which is that people look down on people in trades. And that's a different part of my culture, where it's quite the opposite. Tradesmen are millionaires where I come from. They have five houses and workshops and all of this. So what can we do, and what should be done? What do you feel should be done, and how could it be done to incorporate changes in the curriculum to enable kids to have an opportunity that's outside of the university system?
Thank you, Michael.
Hi, my name is Amr Al-Siabi. My question is, do you think, and I don't want to sound it, don't want it to sound like it's a conspiracy or something, but do you feel that there is a sort of a political decision to not get these Arabic countries and Arab region well educated? And I'm talking especially about Gulf countries, because when we're affluent countries, we have a lot of money running around, and we invest in many other things like weapons or anything, but we seem to not invest enough on education. And you gave examples of, you know, Greece is a country that's been in trouble for many years now, economic problems, but they still managed to produce more academic content. Israel, you know, since its inception, it's been in wars and conflicts, isolated, but they still managed to innovate much more than all Arabic countries combined. So why is the reason? Is there not, are political leaders not convinced that we have to invest?
So are leaders keeping us stupid to follow?
I don't know why, but like that could be a theory. No,
I think good. It's a good question that we'll answer.
And then I think yours was the third last one.
Hi, my question is for Mr. Abdullah. I used to study in Canada, and now I'm continuing my higher education in Jeddah. And one of the biggest things that I've noticed, and one of the biggest problems I've noticed is the attitude towards education from both the students and the teachers. Students, they don't like to be challenged, and whenever they're pushed just a little bit, not all, of course, but what I've noticed is that a lot of them, they seem to give up. And teachers, they seem to also let things slide. There's, as they say in Arabic, there's an attitude of, it's very mashihalik. And I just wanted to know, how can we begin to motivate and try to, students and teachers, and try to overcome this challenge?
So building motivation, capabilities, and grit, I think, to keep going. And great. Okay. So thank you. I didn't get your name.
My name is Omar Fatih.
Omar. Thank you, Omar. So Omar, Amir, and Michael asked us very interesting questions. I'm going to split them out as follows. Maysa, if you could take the question that Michael asked about capabilities and how to build those, incorporating changes in curriculum and building alternative tracks from going into university, perhaps technical and vocational education and careers. Hassan, if you could take the Amir's question. I think that one was pretty clear. And Abdullah, as Omar asked, let's explore how we can build motivation, grit, this mind shift towards performing for excellence, not just performance.
Great. So I've got good and bad news. The good news is that we are masters of our destiny, and there is no one holding us back, and that the keys to our future are ourselves. And the bad news is that we are also the source of all of our own problems. Every country has other countries which are friendly to it, other countries which are indifferent to it, and other countries which are either openly or secretly enemies. This is not any different for China, and their Shanghai's education system is now the best in the world. It's not because America wanted them to be the best in the world, but they also didn't hold them back. I was at Riyadh Airport yesterday, and the people next to me in the lounge were Americans from Chicago who were in Saudi Arabia in order to accredit a university in Al-Kharj. They didn't go to Al-Kharj out of a conspiracy, and they certainly didn't go there for a holiday. They went there to develop the Saudi education system. But here's another interesting fact. You talked about investment, and we're not investing enough. And it's true that some countries in the Arab world are less wealthy, but this region invests the most in education of any region in the world, both as a proportion of GDP and in terms of spend per person. So the problem is not education, investment. The problem is that this is difficult. It's very difficult to build an education system. And the biggest indicator of whether you're going to succeed in school is how well your parents did in school. And this is a new region when it comes to the kind of economy that we're building here. It's a long region in terms of its history in many ways, but this is a new region in terms of the economy and the skills we're trying to build. If you go back three generations, it wasn't the same situation. So you're trying to overcome the barrier of not having had the generations before who were at that level of education. And that's just difficult, and it's going to take time, and there's no guarantee of success, but it's not a conspiracy. The keys are in our hands, I promise you.
So in terms of creating different pathways for young people in the region, I think this is one of the, you know, oldest challenges. It's continuously discussed. Every reform process taking place in almost every country talks about the need to develop vocational education. The fact is that we kind of need to change that argument altogether. It's not that governments don't know that we need to create vocational educational pathways. I mean, most countries have invested actually quite a bit of money into that, but there are all kinds of deeply rooted issues that have now become almost complete barriers to entry into that field. Stigma, lack of understanding of what vocational education can do for a country's, you know, for economies, and also it's sort of the models that exist today are not really the models that we need when it comes to vocational education. Around the world, even in the United States and Canada, vocational education is being completely redefined. So today, actually, to be, you know, the best mechanical, somebody who, you know, fixes cars or fixes computers or whatever it is, you actually do need a good base, a good quality education. What we really need to be thinking about in the region is how do we get more kids to go into STEM education? And maybe for many of them, that doesn't necessarily mean becoming doctors and engineers as we always think, but it is, for example, working in some aspect of telehealth, for example, or robotics, or the new vocational educational sectors. So we really need to spend a lot of time thinking about how we can do that. And I don't necessarily think that it's all about going to university. There are lots of amazing colleges around the world that can be producing, you know, some of the skills that we need. But it's not necessarily an either or. There are skills that young people need in all areas, whether they go to university or not, that we need to work at. And that starts from K to 12. The base is in K to 12.
I'll try to be extremely short because of the time. But I would like to comment on the history thing. I'm sorry you answered it, but I just a very quick comment. I think, as they say, the winner usually writes history. So what's very important is that we give our kids the skills to be able to read from different resources and then evaluate what actually makes sense to be able to read history correctly. I would like to answer Omar through an example to also comment on the gentleman comment as well. I visited a carpenter in Italy, and he's actually driving a Ferrari. And I would like to mention that normal human beings like beautiful things, and if you see the kind of furniture that this guy produced out of his workshop, it's just unbelievable. So when we talk about vocational training or education, we're not only talking about really low income. I mean, and this will take me to answer Omar. I think the problem that we have, mashi halak, always, because we limit our kids into particular certain things. Give them the freedom. There is nothing wrong if they want to be, if they want to be a football player, let them be a football player. It's also something nice to do if they like this, if they want to be doctors. So we don't really need to push them. If you want the young generation to actually love what they're doing, have meaning in their lives, which is basically what we're all trying to do, you definitely need to give them freedom to choose what they want to learn. And I think this way, you're gonna make sure that all the kids would actually like to go to school and would like to pursue their I would say, dreams, in regardless if it's like football or singing or law or anything other than that. Thank you.
A big round of applause for our panelists today. Very well done. I just want to share with you a synthesis a little bit, just some wrapping thoughts before we go. There has been a lot said today, and I think just a quick key things of what I specifically learned, maybe that will be helpful on your way out, so you know what's the next thing that you're going to do to fix the education system. So a big thing that we learned, digital fluency is key, and job market is the ultimate goal, right? So we have to build skills and the right ones to be able to make it into the job market. So that's a big thing that we have to solve for and work towards. The traditional school model is never going to get us there. There is a lot of non-formal education, informal education that's happening outside of the schools. Let's invest in those. And let's try to make those even better and complementary to what's going on into the schools. Knowledge is not separate from the skills that need to use that knowledge to build, right? So let's not forget the bricks when we're thinking about how do we design our homes. Let's also understand that our governments are trying. There's a lot of money that's being spent. How do we divert that money? Let's think of ways to put that money into good use, even better use, and get that, use our keys to build our own future. And finally, STEM. STEM in K through 12 is so important. And if your parents, if you know parents who are not putting their, encouraging their kids to go into STEM fields, help them, tell them, this is what I learned today, and let's get your kids into more STEM-oriented fields. It will have magical impact on their lives and moving forward. And with that, I say goodbye.